Hi, welcome to this video. In this video, I will be talking about one sample t-test, when sigma is unknown, and how to construct a confidence interval for the population mean. We will start by looking at this example. The amount spent on groceries per month by a random sample of 13 students at Sheridan College are recorded below. Test the claim that the average amount students spend per month on groceries is more than $180. Test at 5% confidence level and construct a 90% confidence interval for the population mean. The first thing is for us to find the claim. The claim in this question is that the average amount students spend per month on groceries is more than $180. As a result of this, my claim is going to be the alternative hypothesis. So my null hypothesis will be meal is less than or equal to 180, while my alternative will be meal is greater than 180. My alternative becomes my claim. Next, we are going to be analyzing this by going to Excel. Once we have the data in Excel, we will be fooling Excel to believe that we have two samples. So I will create a second sample where I put the hypothesized value I'm comparing my population mean to, which in this case is 180. I will create that sample and make it the same sample size as the original one. Then I would go to data analysis. On this list, I will look for t-test two sample assuming unequal variances. I will click on OK. And then in the first box, I would highlight and put in the data from the original set that we have. And then in the second box, I'm going to be putting in the data from the one that we created, which is in this second column. Then my hypothesized mean difference, I will put as 0. And my alpha, which is given in the question, 5%, 0.05. Then I'll click OK. Immediately, my output comes here. So looking at this table, I have some summary statistics, my test statistics, and then I'm performing a one-tailed test, so I'll be taking these two values. Based on the results from this table, I'm going to be performing the test. Looking at this table again, I see here the test statistic, which is 2.98. I'm going to show you real quick how to compute that manually. If we wanted to compute that value manually, we would use this formula. The sample mean, if it is given to you, or we can be able to see it from here, is 188.08. The hypothesized mean value that we are comparing the population mean to is 180 from our hypothesis test. My standard deviation, again, this value may have been given to you, or you can find it from your summary statistics. It will be the square root of the variance, which is given right here in our output. And my N, I can also see it in the output here, is 13. If I put these values together, it gives me the same as what we have from the output, which is 2.98. The other value we need is the critical value. Again, the critical value can be obtained by putting this formula into any cell in Excel. The area on one tail, since it's a one-tailed right-tailed test, is 0.05. And the degrees of freedom is n minus 1, in this case, is 12. If I put this value into Excel, it returns negative 1.78. But again, it is a right-tailed test. It is the same area that is on the right tail. So I will pick the positive value. I can also obtain this value from a t-distribution table. Next, we are going to be looking at how to make our decision. If we look at the test, it's a one-tailed t-test. The area on the right tail is 5%. The corresponding critical value is 1.78. the test statistic we obtained as 2.98 is greater than the critical value. So as a result of that, we say the test statistic is greater than the critical value. So the test statistic falls in the rejection region. Hence, we reject the null hypothesis. We can also use the p-value to make the same decision. We can get the p-value by using this formula right here. We'll type this into any cell in Excel. This value, again, this is the test statistic that we have put in here, the degrees of freedom, and true because it's cumulative. Now, this will give us the area below that point. So because it's a right tail test, we have to subtract that from 1. So if we subtract that from 1, we get a p-value of 0.0057. Again, if we look in the Excel output we saw earlier, this is the same value we have in there. So if we compare this to alpha, it will be less than alpha. So again, we reject the null hypothesis. We can thus conclude that at 5% level of significance, we have sufficient evidence to support the claim. Again, the claim in this case is the alternative hypothesis. Next, we talk about how to find the 90% confidence interval for the population mean. To do that, we use this formula where our E is the margin of error and our X bar is the sample mean we saw earlier. My margin of error will be obtained by taking the critical value, the area on one tail here. Since my alpha is 0.10, alpha over 2 will be 0.05. So this critical value is the same as what we saw earlier, which is 1.78. We already know the sample standard deviation, again, from the information we have earlier, and n, the sample size, which is 13. After computing the margin of error, using that formula, we get 4.82. Then we take the sample mean, we add and subtract the margin of error to get the upper and lower confidence limit. We can be able to obtain the upper confidence limit by taking X bar plus the margin of error, and the lower confidence limit by taking X bar minus the margin of error. Once we have obtained these two values, we can write down our confidence intervals in this form. If we notice again, 0 does not fall in this interval. So that means we need to reject the null hypothesis, which supports the decision we made earlier. We can now interpret our confidence interval as follows. We are 90% confident that the population mean amount spent is between $183.25 and $192.90. Thank you for watching this video.